Hello, everyone. My name is Jeff Bullock. Welcome to Manna Church High Point's online messaging. As we always say, thank you for letting us be a part of your life today, whenever and wherever you are listening to this message. Do me a favor, go to our website, hit our Connect Card tab, and just let us know that you are with us today. We want to hear from you. We're going to jump right into the message. We're in week two of a series called TenTalks. We're looking at the book of Exodus in chapter 12, where God lays out the Ten Commandments, famously known, published everywhere in the United States at different times. But as Rick pointed out last week when preaching, the Ten Commandments really are not a set of do's and a set of don'ts as much as they're a specific roadmap of how we can live our best life ever, our happiest life ever. These commands are not really given to us by God to impose a standard on us that we have to measure up to, but really are a revelation of His nature and character. It's a revelation of how God actually exists and acts based on His nature, and we need to understand that. These aren't the do's and don'ts. In fact, let me take you back. When Moses first met God on the mountain, God revealed Himself as fire in a bush, and the bush was not consumed. And you kind of got to ask the question, why did God reveal Himself to Moses in this way? He didn't just reveal Himself as some big God who was angry with people. He revealed Himself as a burning bush, as we have it. And let me just suggest two reasons why God revealed Himself in a burning bush. There must be more, and there's more insight. But number one, fire actually needs fuel to exist. You've got to have something. If you've got a lighter, you've got butane. If you got wood, it's burning. It's got to have fuel to exist. But this fire isn't burning the bush as fuel. The fire is actually self-existent. Secondly, the bush is actually real. God's using something in reality. See, God is revealing to us that He is not of this world and isn't dependent on this world. God is not fueled by anything here. God is self-existent, but He is as real as the bush is. So these commandments are not born as a result of this world, the commandments that God is giving us, but the world is actually born as a result of these commandments, as a result of His nature. Not of this world, but very real. And so this is what we're trying to get across. These are not just do's and don'ts. This is a revelation of God's character and nature. And that's what He's constantly trying to do as he revealed Himself to Moses in a burning bush. So instead of going through Exodus 20 and reading through all 10 commandments, I want to approach this a little bit like a story, almost a God having a conversation with us, so that maybe, possibly, these 10 commandments, these instructions, this roadmap, comes across a little bit more relational and in context. So just imagine God reveals Himself to a people who are living their lives based on their experiences, in other words, by trial and error, or based on their senses, what they see, feel, touch, and see, and their feelings, their mood swings. And God comes to those people. Well, who are those people? Of course, that's us. And He wants us, actually, He comes to us, and He wants us to live our best lives ever, maximizing, being able to, in this life, maximize our relationships, our decision-making, our career choices, to maximize our joys, to maximize our happiness, our contentment, our satisfaction. And then He tells them, He says, look, you've been living by your experiences, you've been living by your feelings, you've just been living by your senses. And the way you've been living actually undermines and destroys the very things you want to have the most, a happy, fulfilled life. The way you live that way actually undermines your best life ever. So they say, well then how should we live? So God says, okay, if we're going to do this thing and you really want me to share with you how you can maximize and have your best life ever, then we have to agree on something. First, I'm going to be your God, and that means I belong to you. Secondly, you're going to be my people. That means you belong to me. It's like a marriage. I belong to you, and you belong to me like a marriage. And based on that relationship, God basically says, let me share with you how to live the best life possible. So write this down. Write it down. So I'm going to share these commandments. First, he says, first, there can be no other gods but me. He says, I know you. Imagine God's having a conversation with you. And he says, I know you and all the other people on the earth think that they know how what's important, what's most important, and what should be at the core of your lives, but you actually have it all wrong. I know everything because I'm God. I created everything. So let me be at the center of your life. That's important, because if I'm not at the center, then you will get it wrong, as you have already proven. So the first one is, let me be at the center of your life, nothing else. Therefore, since I'm going to be the center of your life, then don't make anything out of wood or stone that actually represents me. And don't think that anything in the heavens or anything on the earth or anything in the air or anything in the water are God. Nothing that you can see can be me. Nothing. Because nothing you can see will be able to be impartial or fair about what is right and what is wrong. Nothing other than me can determine what should be punished and what should be shown mercy. I have got to be at the core of your life, and don't make anything that represents me, and don't think anything that you can see can be me. Now, since I'm your only God and you're not making anything else, I'm your God, I want you to take my name. Let my name now be your name. We have the same name. Now, don't misrepresent my name. Don't take my name as your name and live as if we don't belong together. That would be taking my name, get it? My name in vain. Take my name, it's your name. Now live in such a way that actually represents my name and do it the way I say. If not, you're taking my name in vain. And since my name is your name and we're in this thing together, you can rest in this one thing. You can rest in this one thing, that I am always yours and you are always mine, and there's nothing that you can do that can separate those two things. So just take a day and rest. Rest in this. And this is the commandment about the Sabbath. Now, since you honor me in this way, resting and trusting in me completely, in a similar way, I want you also to honor your parents. Just as you're honoring me in this way, honor your parents. In the same sense that I share your name, we're sharing the same name, you share the same name with your family. And just as I gave birth to all of creation, so they gave birth to you. Honor your father and your mother. Now, that takes care of us. This takes care of your family. Now, for those of you who aren't, those of the people that aren't in your family, treat them with dignity and with respect, just as you would treat me and your own family. So, don't murder. Don't murder anyone just because you disagree with them, get angry with them, or they block you from getting what you want. If you have a wife, if you're married, don't act like someone else is your wife also. That would be adultery. Don't take stuff from anyone that doesn't belong to you. It belongs to them. So don't steal their stuff. And don't say anything about anybody that's not true. That just makes sense. Say what you know only. And lastly, and this may be the hardest one, God tells us, he's saying, look, don't desire to have what someone else has. Don't wish someone else was your wife to be your wife. Don't wish someone else's house was your house, or their stuff your stuff. Just be content with what you have. Those are 10 things. And if you will do these things from your heart, God is telling us, you will live the best life you can possibly have in this life. This is the way that God says, I live towards you. I'm sharing something with you that the nations and other peoples don't understand, but it's very precious. I'm sharing with you my very nature, and I'm sharing with you my very heart, my very image. So God is basically telling us, when you see someone live like this, it will be as if you're looking at me. See, these Ten Commandments are a very revelation and expression of the nature and character of God. And when we live like this, when people see us live like this, it's as if we're not God, but it's as if they're seeing the very nature. They're actually seeing God Himself. Jesus said it like this in John 14, 8 and 9. One of His disciples said, his name is Philip, said to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." And Jesus looked at him and said, "Have I been with you so long and you have not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father?" What Jesus is saying is, I am the very nature, expression of His nature. I live and act just like God. And so when you look at me, you are actually seeing what God is like. Let me just say something about the don'ts, because oftentimes we come to the Ten Commandments and we just feel like, don't do this and don't do that. There's a limitation to our life. But let me share something this way. Imagine you're just hired as a big machine operator in a large manufacturing facility, a huge machine. And you're being trained by your supervisor on how to operate this machine. And your training supervisor starts your training off with these instructions. He says, "Look, in a moment, I'm going to show you how to operate this machine. But before I tell you anything about how to do this machine, let me tell you this. Don't ever do this. It'll take off your hand. And don't ever lean over this machine. It'll take your life. And the other stuff, don't do those two things because it'll ruin your life. But the other stuff you'll learn along the way. But if you do those things, not only will it take your life, you'll malfunction the machine. The machine will malfunction." I would call those kinds of don'ts from the supervisor positive negatives. So when God says don't, it's actually to preserve our life, not to limit our life. It's actually, if we don't do these things, it actually makes us more free. If I don't do this thing on that machine, I get to keep my hand, and now I have freedom to use my hand in much more creative ways. Jesus said it like this. John 10:10. The thief, sin and Satan, comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. You see, sin, which is what these things are telling us to avoid, sin steals life from you. It separates you from God. It steals life from you. Sin kills life in you. It will make you discontent. You will always want more and more and never be content. Sin destroys life around you. Sin steals life from you. It kills life in you and destroys life around you. It will hurt others. See, God wants us to run well. He wants us to be in this life, and He's trying to tell us how to have the best life ever and to finish well. Not only to live well, but also to finish the race well. The writer of Hebrews said, lay aside the sin that so easily entangles you and gets wrapped all around you so that you can run the race that's set before us. As an example, I want you to just watch this short video real quick.
Paul Pepperd, it's neck and neck. Oh my God, neck and neck. Jenny Mac. He's butchered the defining. That is a fact. He has to be.
Isn't that amazing? Here this guy is running, and the simile of a runner on a track getting tangled seems almost absurd, but it happened. But it is a picture of how easily we can be hindered from running well and finishing the race as a winner. God wants us to be free to run, while sin and Satan want us tangled up to hold us back from living our best life in God. Jesus said, "I came that you would have life and have it abundantly." I came. Sin comes to steal, to entangle you. And that's what these commandments have said. Don't do this because it's going to just entangle you. It's going to cause you to not be able to run. It's going to hinder you from running, but it will stop you from winning. See, God comes to give us his life. And then he says, "I don't just give you enough life. I give you more life than you need. I give you abundant life." And why does God give us more life than we need? He gives us more so that we can share it with others. So let's read the second commandment. Let's read the one that we're going to be focusing on today. Exodus 20, 4 through 6. "You shall not make for yourselves an idol or any likeness of what is in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the water underneath the earth. You shall not worship them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children, on the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing loving kindness to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments." So, the first commandment is, you shall have no other gods besides me. The second commandment basically tells us this. The second gives us the why to the first commandment. You shall have no other gods besides me because there's just nothing that compares to me. In other words, don't make something and call it me and worship me in a false manner. Because there's nothing you can make that can even come close to measuring up to what I am. It just stands to reason that God cannot be adequately represented in any form from nature. You know, it used to be, before electronic counterfeit bill detectors existed, that employees were trained to detect counterfeit bills by giving the real deal, be giving the real bill. And they would feel it and feel it and feel it. And then when something counterfeit or false crossed through their fingers, they would be able to detect it. And we would think that the more time we spend with God and spend with God and spend with God and spend with God, experiencing the real deal of God's presence and his nature and his very character, that it would be easy for us to identify anything that's counterfeit or false. But it's kind of interesting because the heart is just a tricky thing, and it's not as easy as you might think, because the heart is always longing to worship. And here's the thing, it's constantly longing to worship something that it can see, feel, taste, touch, something physical in this world. We don't like this idea of not being able to feel it, see it, smell it. Worship means no less than this, but it means so much more. Our worship is directed to what we draw our ultimate comfort from, safety, and trust from. See, the heart is always longing, and it always wants to set its affection on something that it can see. See, what we worship is what we draw our comfort, safety, and trust in. What we direct our worship that way. Someone can draw their comfort and safety from people. We can make idols of our spouse, of a child, of a parent, or even a close friend. And many people make their kids their ultimate comfort and their idol, especially if their spouse is distant. We also can make idols out of hobbies. When we get stressed and anxious, all those things can get the best of us, and we can go to those things that give us comfort. Could be a sport, could be making things, it could be something in nature. Could be work. Now it could be pets. Could be entertainment. And often, our idol is our own definition of how we define what success is, and we're striving to get that because we think if we can get to that success, it'll bring us the comfort, trust, security that we need. But God is telling us in this second commandment to especially be careful of making anything we see an idol, because what you look at, you will become like. Let me read out of Psalm 135. The idols of the nations are but silver and gold, the work of man's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. They have eyes, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear, nor is their breath at all in their mouths. Here it is. Those who make them will become like them. Yes, everyone who trusted them. See, this really is the sad part. Our hearts are drawn to trust in physical stuff that we can see, touch, and smell. And when we set our heart on something other than God, we actually become like those things in nature and spiritually, in our character, in our hearts. We become deaf, blind, breathless, without real life. Many people have done this. I've done this. More than likely, you have done this. That you've set yourself, you've set something, you've set your heart and affection on something other than God and kind of not even knowing it. You know, during the economic crisis in 2007, 2008, a string of suicides took place among formerly wealthy and well-connected individuals. The CFO of Freddie Mac hanged himself in his own basement. The chief executive of Sheldon Good shot himself in his red Jaguar. A French money investor who managed many of Europe's royal and leading families' finances lost $1.4 billion of their investments, and then he slit his wrists. A Danish HSBC bank executive hanged himself in his $600 a night hotel room. A Bear Stearns executive, after learning he would be fired, leapt from the 29th floor of his building. People who had set their affections on something that they thought would bring them security, but it let them down. Tim Keller wrote in his book, Counterfeit Gods, he said this, in 1830, Alex, I'm going to say his name, hopefully properly, Alex de Tocqueville, wrote in his famous Observations of America, a strange melancholy haunts the inhabitants of the Americas in the midst of their abundance. Americans believed, he goes on, that prosperity could quench their yearning for happiness, but such a hope was illusory because Tocqueville added, the incomplete joys of this world will never satisfy the human heart. This dissatisfaction with making anything in this world an idol in our lives always leads to despair. Hear this. God says, don't do this. Don't set your affection on anything here because it will always lead you every single time to despair. See, the difference between sorrow and despair is this, because we all can get sorrowful. Sorrow comes from losing one good thing among others, so that if you experience a career reversal, for example, you can find comfort in your family to get through it. But despair, however, is inconsolable because it comes from losing an ultimate thing. When you lose an ultimate thing in your life, an idol, you lose your source of ultimate hope and meaning, of which there is no source to turn to for comfort. See, idolatry is what we're talking about. God's saying, don't do that. Don't make an idol out of anything. Idolatry comes from taking some incomplete joy of this world and building your entire life on it. That's why God says, I should be your only God, because there's nothing in this world that can exist in my category of existence. I will always complete what is incomplete in your life, and nothing else in this world can actually do that. You see, he says, don't do that because it will kill, steal, and destroy. It will take your life. But if you let me be that, whatever is incomplete in your life, I will make up for that so that you will be whole. Without me, you can't be whole. But with me, you can. Therefore, don't set your heart on anything else. You know, it's also interesting to me that God implies, don't even make anything that represents me. Not only, like, don't take your phone, or don't take your wife, or don't take your kids, or your definition of success and make an idol. But then he says, don't even say, okay, I'm going to worship God, and I'm going to make an image, and I'm going to call it God. And I'm going to worship it in that way. See, in Exodus, after you get, like, Exodus 32, Exodus 33, Exodus 34, Moses goes up to the mountain of God, and God gives him these Ten Commandments on stone. He cuts them out. He writes them, it says, with the finger of God, and he gives them to them. And then Moses, when he goes down the mountain to deliver these commandments to the people, he finds that they're partying. And not only that, they have taken their gold, and they've fashioned a statue of a calf out of gold, and they're worshiping it. And they actually say, this is what they did. They said, this is your God. This is God. We can't see him, so we're going to make this idol. This is your God who brought you out of Egypt. See, they weren't really trying to replace God. They were saying, this thing is actually going to represent God. Moses comes down when he sees this idol. He takes those Ten Commandments. He throws it at the calf. The calf is destroyed. The commandments, are because they're made out of stone, are broken into pieces. And then Moses goes back up the mountain, so God can give him another set, a new set of commandments written on these stones. And in Exodus 34, Moses goes up, 33 and 34, he goes up the mountain, and he's getting these commandments, and he's having this really special moment with God. And as God gives him these commandments, Moses looks at God and is looking and relating to God. And he says, God, my request, I want to see your face. I want to see a material, natural representation of who you are. I want to see your face. Reveal yourself to me. Let me see your face. God responded, no one can actually see me physically and live. But hide yourself in the cleft of the rock, and I will cause all my goodness. I will cause all my goodness to pass before you, and will proclaim the name of the Lord. Exodus 34, 6, then the Lord passed in front of Moses and proclaimed. He passed in front of Moses while Moses is hiding in the rock. He passes in front of Moses and proclaims. Doesn't say he reveals, he proclaims. The Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity and transgression of sin. Yet, he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished, visiting the iniquity on the fathers and on their children and on their grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. Moses made haste to bow low before the earth and worship. See, Moses wanted to see God physically, but God says, I don't want you to see me physically. I want you to see me always with the eyes of your heart. This is the second commandment. Don't make something. See me with the eyes of your heart. And when God did reveal himself to Moses, it wasn't physically, but in proclamations. Don't miss that. God says, this is me. This is who, quote, I am. Compassionate and gracious. Proclamations. This is I am. Slow to anger. Forgiving sin and transgression. God did reveal himself, but it wasn't physically, but in proclamations. And in fact, when he proclaims twice, the Lord, the Hebrew word is Yahweh. It means supreme. I am the supreme one. I am the creator. I am almighty. I am the eternal one. I am uncreated. I have no limits. I'm without measure. Infinite in power, infinite in purity, infinite in holiness, limitless in gentleness, limitless in kindness, limitless in patience and hospitality. See me this way with the eyes of your heart. I am. That's what he says. And then God says, if that's not enough about who I am the only one who can also bless your life and the life of your children and your children's children with loving kindness and forgiveness. And also, I am the only one, who can bring justice. Nothing compares to me. So don't make anything that you can physically see and worship it. See me with the eyes of your heart and worship me only, is what God says. Nothing compares to me. I'm high and lifted up. I'm self-existent, yet I come down into the reality now. I dwell with those who see me from their eyes of their heart. Jesus said the same thing in John 4. He said, but an hour is coming, and now is. That's you and I. An hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers. What kind of worshipers? The true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For such people, what kind of people? Those who see God with the eyes of their heart. For such people, the Father seeks to be his worshipers. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. To worship in spirit means worship and see God with the eyes of your heart. And truth means knowing his character and his very nature. Let's swing back to this commandment, Exodus 20. God says, you shall not worship or serve idols. And then he says, for I am a jealous God. I remember hearing a famous talk show host saying, when they read that when they were younger, that God was jealous. They decided right then and there God couldn't be their God, because how could God be jealous of me? And if God is jealous of me, then he must not be much of a God. In that kind of reason, I would agree 100%. See, when God says he's jealous, it's not the way we get jealous, though. That's not how he's defining jealousy here. We have jealousy over rivals. He got that promotion that I wanted, and I get jealous. Or I get jealous over stuff. They have a better house than I have. Jealousy is always petty, and is a form of anger and hate that comes from comparison. When God says he's a jealous God, he's not talking about the kind of jealousy that this talk show host understood it to be. God is not jealous because of you, but he is jealous over you. He wants you to have the best life ever and is protective over you, knowing that idols will steal your life. But he has a life that he wants to give you that is abundant. And you know, to prove it, that God's not jealous of us. He's not jealous of our car. He's not jealous of our looks. There's nothing in this world that can compare to him. God is so jealous over us, though, protective of us, that he was willing to do for us what we could not do for ourselves, which actually is the definition of grace. Grace is God doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves. You see, God saw sin and Satan stealing and killing and destroying our lives. He saw us giving us the very nature and care, revealing that to us, and us still not living up to that, did something. He was so jealous over us and seeing our failures. See, that's the thing, seeing our failures. The Bible says the second person of the Trinity, the eternal Son, became a man. He came down to us to experience the same things that we experience. He died on a cross for us, and therefore transferring us out of this kingdom of darkness, out of this recurring cycle of sin, stealing and killing. He did away with that. He broke the power of sin in our lives and transferred us from darkness to the kingdom of God. And he broke sin and death over us. And then he did something final and eternal. The Bible says he crushes Satan's head. He did this. See, God's jealousy over us and what he has for us so moved him to not consider his own life, but moved him to sacrifice himself so that we could be, so that we wouldn't be separated from him anymore. That sin wouldn't kill us on the inside. It wouldn't destroy those around us. And he didn't do that for us. I mean, for himself, he did that for us. This is what that second command is about. Is God wanting to be at the center of our lives so that we might have life and glory and bask and enjoy his nature and character forever. If you have never experienced God this way, maybe you see him as a God that's always trying to limit your life or give you standards to live up to that you constantly fail at. That's not what God's trying to do. He's really giving us a comparison. He's saying, you're living by your experiences. You're living by your feelings. You're living by your senses. And that's a bad way to live. It actually undermines the very life I have for you. This is my nature. These summed up in these 10 commands. If you've never understood, God wants to reveal himself, not a morality to you. Oh, you've just really missed Christianity altogether. God wants to know you, but more importantly, he wants you to know him. He wants to be your God, and he wants you to be his son or daughter. It really is as simple as praying a prayer, but it's not the prayer that matters. It's believing that God will come to you and reveal himself to you. In fact, if you're wanting to pray that prayer, God already has. The Holy Spirit already has revealed himself, which is the very presence of God. And you can pray and you can ask God to come take your life. Not take your life by physically, but come and be the Lord of your life. Be the one, the boss of your life. It's showing you really how to live. And that's called repentance. When you don't want to live your life your way, to live your life based on your experiences and senses and feelings. Those things aren't bad, but they undermine the way God wants us to live. In other words, he wants to tell us what his nature is like and how we can live that regardless of how we feel about it. And when we do that, the Bible says, when we say, okay, I want to do this, I want to live this way, that's called repentance. We change our mind on the way we want to live. But not only that, the way we change our mind, it changes our actions and what we do. And then we begin to take his name and we begin to bear his name. And his name becomes our name. And we don't want to live a life that is in vain, that just shows that I'm just taking his life and not living it. So we're not talking about just praying a prayer and not living life, but really coming to know the person of who Christ is. If you want to do that, pray this prayer. Just say, Jesus, come in my life and be Lord in Jesus' name. If you've done that, would you do me a favor? Would you go to our website? Let us know you prayed that prayer. We'd like to speak with you, email you. We want to put materials in hand so that you can find a community, be with a community, and find God and grow in him. Now listen, if you joined us today and you enjoy what you're hearing here, and maybe you consider Manna Church High Point your church, can I encourage you to go to our website and hit the Give tab and give. These messages, honestly, not our articulation of the messages, but the spirit of the message, the spirit of the Bible, it will change your life. Let's partner together to grow together, to know God, but also to advance his kingdom and accomplish the mission that we've done together. Go to our website, hit the Give tab, and would you give, would you tithe? There's ways you can give to mission, you can give to the church. Thank you for your partnership, and thank you for your generosity. God will bless you. He wants to bless your life. More than anything, as we give him those things that are most secret and precious to us, and then he gives us those things that are most secret and precious to him, his very understanding and nature. Hey, loving this series. Can't wait to see you next week. We'll be hitting the third commandment about not taking the Lord's name in vain, which we've already alluded to, but you don't want to miss next week. My wife's going to bring a fantastic message to you. We love you. We'll see you next time. And now I know that this is the good life. Never look back when I traded for a day in my own life. Never look back cause I know that you are always with me. I got you, I know you got me. This is the good life. You gave me the good life. I always thought that I'd be fine chasing all the things that left me dead inside.